Yeah, good evening everyone. Hope be able to hear me. So today's topic is about big data modeling, and there is a sandwich kind of session, machine learning with no code. For machine learning, the underlying data is important. So without good quality data, whatever analysis you do, and you automate and produce results, it's going to be a terribly wrong results. So we need to concentrate on data. And today's world is generating a lot of data. So big data. So not only gathering the data, how fast you are. Yeah, not only gathering the data, but also how fast you are processing, how efficiently you are storing, securely storing, and also you need to govern the data. Since a lot of compliance standards are there, whether it is PII data or PCI data, so any company who stores, collect the data, they should be following those compliance. Yes, all we know, data is an asset. So my CEO, he used to tell data is a king. So data need to be secured, and also it need to be processed, no? So when you are processing the data, we need to take the meaningful information. So when you take the meaningful data, it will become information. Once you process the information, you can generate knowledge out of the data. So once you generate the knowledge, you are the powerful man, powerful company. So Google is an example. So they started collecting the data, they are able to manage the rule the world, we can say, correct? And so collecting the data, so when you start collecting the data, so in today's world, human beings, we are generating the data, either Facebook or we are sending emails, and systems, automated system, for example, car, all smart devices, they are generating the data, all sensors, lot of sensors, CCTV cameras, so those systems are generating, organizations, they are generating, for example, bank customers or any other customers, they are generating the data. So these are the sources. So because of this abundant data, so we need to generate value, you know. So that is the primary importance of storing the data or collecting the data. So not only collecting one side of the data, you need to be able to connect these data. So for that, you need to integrate. So integration will give the data collaboration. You can efficiently manage the data also once you integrate and combine those data sets. And this is the common terminology for big data. So it's 5 V's. The people might say 6 V's, 7 V's, but I will concentrate on 5 V's. Since it's a lot of devices, human beings we are generating, it's in huge volumes, and also the speed in which the data comes, that also we need to consider, the velocity of the data and veracity, how it differs or compared to the existing data, how it varies, and variety. For example, you have audio data, video data, text data. So these are the variety of data, and valence also. So these are the characteristics for any big data company or any solution. So once you able to gather these data, you should be able to get insights. Insights will give you value. So based on that value, you can take business decision that in turn converted into a revenue. So as I told earlier, so managing that data, whatever we collected, is so important. Compliance reasons, so many reasons are there. Security, data security is an important. Collecting data is not a big deal, but today you can see companies like Facebook or other companies, they are asked to justify why you collected the data. What is the reason behind that? So managing the data is also important, and that in turn requires the data governance. Who can access the data? Who can modify the data? All those things. So this is how we can process the data. We understood where it originates, how it comes, how to manage those, but actual data, you need to acquire, these are the steps in the big data processing. You need to acquire the data, first you need to identify what kind of data we need, where to store, how to retrieve, how to query, and you need to prepare the data and pre-processes. So, if it is a completely new data, you don't know like what is the data, you need to pre-processes and explore the data to understand the data better. And based on that, that requires analytical techniques and you need to build the models for those. And so once you able to get some meaningful information out of the data, you can report the data, so that will become an asset. And we can apply the result and make decisions on that, based on that. So, the same process, so acquiring, preparing, analyzing, acting. So, this is a continuous process, it is not going to stop. So, you will get more input data, you need to acquire and generate the knowledge. And these are the challenges now. So, once you collect the data, so the volume is increasing, the speed is also increasing, you need to be able to scale the data, like incoming volume of data, the big data. And not only collecting, the data should give a value and it should be shared and optimized for the, not only for a particular text data only I can process, you cannot tell that. So, the processing technique or model should support variety of data and it should be fault or something goes wrong. It is a big data means all distributed systems. So, even a failure of node, one node will not affect the overall performance. So, this is the fundamental big data ecosystems. So, you need a storage, maybe I can, HDFS is a Hadoop distributed file system, that is the storage. On top of that, you need to run the jobs, query the data and also able to generate graphical information, or if you want to stream like batch processing, or you want to like stream the data. So, these are the options, no? Storm or Spark, and storing the data into a columnar database like NoSQL. So, these are the options, HBase, Cassandra and MongoDB. So, HDFS, I already told, it is a Hadoop distributed file systems where you can store massive parallel data inside it. And Yarn is for scheduling the jobs, I think it was introduced by Yahoo. And MapReduce is like here only that big data, you are storing in multiple places and you want to reduce the data into like MapReduce by using MapReduce function. So, one of the thing is the Google MapReduce. And Hive and Pick are like how to like query the data. So, I was explaining about the querying part. So, Hive is like a SQL kind of thing. Instead of translating the data into another format, on top of HDFS you can run the query, Hive queries. It is like more of SQL, whoever is familiar with structured query language, they can write SQL. Pig is like high level language, again it is for querying only, but it is comparatively low level language compared to the high one. You can see Pig also created by Yahoo and Hive was created by Facebook. So, I think I already explained about Storm, Spark and Flink. So, these are for stream processing. HBase, Cassandra or NoSQL databases. So, how to manage all these things? You can synchronize and configure using a zookeeper. So, all these underlying. I think we can come back to this one later. So, that is the basic ecosystem, big data ecosystem. But this slide is for so, we have a lot of cloud vendors like AWS, Microsoft and Google, IBM. So, since we are going to talk about the machine learning, which platform supports most of the machine learning capabilities? this is not my perspective. I got the data from the Alexsoft. Okay, so it says Microsoft comparatively with AWS to Google, Microsoft covers a lot of machine learning capabilities. So just for understanding. Yeah, I talked about the data management part. So data management requires data governance. So when you talk about data governance, it touches all parts of the data, data security, master data, your transaction processing, OLTP systems, or your reporting or data warehouse, and also whether it is content management or data quality management, data architecture. So everything is covered under one umbrella. It's called data governance. So once you have data governance implemented in your company, it's easy to manage all sort of these issues arises, and also compliance also it's easy. So these are the current challenges. Companies are collecting a lot of data, but they don't know how to manage and govern the data. And another challenge is, if I have the data, whether I can create a view of my company data, where it starts, where it ends, what are the originating systems, who are the consumers for their data, if any breach happens, where to start, how to locate, all those things. And compliance related, GDPR is one of the complaints. I think the California privacy law is that is another complaint. So if you want to implement that, you need to know exact physically where it is stored. So then only you can like implement the compliance on those systems. And to be compliant on GDPR, you need to show where data is stored, how data is stored. If particular person is requesting to delete the data, how that is managed. So those proofs need to be submitted, otherwise heavy fine companies need to pay. And critical reports for the company. So many companies, they struggle with this one. So finance will tell this is my for like revenue. The other department will tell no, no, this is the correct one. To avoid this, data should be managed, governed, and they should tell where it starts, what is the starting point of the report, where it ends, and also reports should be able to certify it at the company level, and everybody should agree for that. I think I already covered these points. What are those? Who maintains, who owns, and simple terminology is, if you go and ask customer, in many companies there will be 150 definitions for the customer within the company. So because there is no proper governance and data management. So in order to maintain the data, like govern the data, so there are tools available. So in our company we used a data governance tool called Colibra. And these are the basic requirements for the data governance tool. Once I was able to feed the data governance tool, capture all metadata about my data, I should be access those data, metadata, or, and also it should be able to access by not only by a technical team, it should be business friendly, and people should be able to collaborate and able to integrate with other systems. Instead of feeding manually, it should integrate and get the metadata from the other systems. Once I capture the metadata, I should be able to find out. For example, I told about customer. If I want to know the customer, what is the definition across the enterprise, I should be able to find out. And also, I should be able to connect individual organization, individual systems, individual business units, definition for each and every terminology used in the company. So that we can achieve using a data governance tool that is called cataloging. Once you prepare the catalog, it's available across the company. So instead of recreating new terminologies, people can use it and store the information and that too you can apply the data quality wherever is required and the compliance wherever required. So this is the second part of my talk. Since we all understood now like data is important, securely available, how to generate knowledge out of that data. So one of the problem with industry is learning the tools. So it's particularly machine learning and all, you need to have in-depth knowledge of the tool or some programming like Python or R. Otherwise, you cannot, even though you have data, you cannot use the data and generate some automated or predictive modeling. So I'm not marketing for Knime. I just want to give an introduction about the Knime. Knime is the open source machine learning tool. Maybe some of you might have heard that tool. It's an open source. It supports a lot of machine learning algorithms. Knime is having an analytical platform, so you can download and install on your machine. It's open source. If you want a enterprise quality, you can go for the server based one. And one of the advantages, no coding experience required, just plug and play. If you know the algorithm, you can search whether it is available or you can import from the marketplace. And extension, Knime extensions are available, you can use it. Yeah, there are community editions also, third party contributions. The another advantage of using Knime is the Knime, you can, whatever I explain, you can acquire the data. For example, I have a file, I want to ingest that file. So this tool, you can just plug and play. You need to know the, just give the path of the file. It will ingest the file and you can play around that file with the, all the machine learning algorithm. Whatever you need is available within Knime. It's easy to use also. It can work as a standalone platform or you want to integrate with Python or Spark. So there are capabilities within Knime. You can integrate and use it. Some intro about Knime. Knime was introduced in 2008. Why it is called Knime? That is the name of the expansion for Knime. It's a university initiated tool. They used to call it as a interactive tool. You can use it for pre-processing, analyzing, analysis and modeling. As I told you, you can integrate with the machine learning languages, whatever currently available in the market. So Knime supports all the integration. It's also having the capability to integrate with the AWS and Azure. Also capability to integrate with the Weka, Plotly, Keras and H2O. These are the some of the open source readily available neural network based systems. So what it contains is more of a technical thing. Knime can integrate. Knime is having the extensions, the analytical platform, that is the, if you are a standalone user, you can use the analytical platform. And if you want to build a enterprise quality server, you can go for the Knime server. And if you need additional extension, you can go and download the community edition or Knime extensions. So as I told, so Knime is capable of loading, integrating, transforming, analyzing, and visualizing all this in one place. Some deep dive into Knime. So everything in Knime is called as nodes. For example, I want to load the data, ingest the data. So a file reader, for example, that will be connected to the output, another node. So all are connected via nodes only. So you can connect all these nodes and create a pipeline. So that is called workflow. Within Knime, it is called workflow. So you can see in the bottom, there is a file reader. And you can filter a particular, like I have 7 columns, I need only 5 columns, you can filter the rest of the 2 columns, and row also you can filter out, and you can generate the graph on the fly. Okay. And once you build the workflow connecting all these nodes, you can find out what is the node status. So node can be in these 4 status. Either not configured means it is red, you can see that when I saw the demo, you can notice that. And once it is configured, connected, it will be in amber or yellow. Executed means green, error out means it will be red. And these are the big picture about the big data platforms and the tools available in the market. This would be the first one. I think we already discussed about the Knime capability. So open source analytical platform, server capability is there, and it can integrate with other tools and also REST APIs. And one of the advantages is extension. How to use the tool? So first you need the tool. So just go to Knime.com. Download based on your operating system, you can choose either Windows or Linux or Mac versions are available. Download it, register. Once you download, the tool will be available, ready to use. So once you configure the server, you can share it in the cloud platform. It is available in, I think I already touched upon all those things. So once you install and open the Knime, this is the screen. So you will have the Explorer, Knime Explorer, and Workflow Coach, and this is the important node. And this is the Workflow Editor, where you can plug and play the nodes and create the pipelines. Some of the business use case, you can go for any predictive modeling using Knime, there is address duplication. For example, if you have data, name and address data, if you want to duplicate those address using machine learning, that capability is also there. There are examples, ready to use examples available. Customer churning, if you want to do, there is a ready to do examples. Before going to my thank you slide, let me open the Knime. It might take few seconds. Any questions?
Maybe I can ask. Yeah. I found it is more similar to the Tableau, because you can also do the node and overlap with the different tables, connect with the different servers. I was initially thinking it's more kind of a platform for like a Python or TensorFlow. Then I found it's more kind of a Tableau.
The Tableau is.
How you guys are different than them, like Power BI or Tableau?
Those are visualization tools, no? So there is no much machine learning or machine learning capability within those tools. I think she is asking comparatively Tableau and Knime look similar, what is the difference? So Tableau is more of a visualization tool, less machine learning capabilities, but this is a heavy duty machine learning tool. On top of that, you can do whatever Tableau can do, ingesting the data, visualizing the data. On top of that, you can apply all these models and all, that is not there.
Is it open source? If I'm going to use for my own data, is my data is available to the public or it's for my own system?
If you install this one, the standalone version, it will be within your machine.
There is no anybody can have access to my data.
No.
It's not a public domain.
It's not a public domain as long as you install only the standalone one.
Okay.
If you configure the server one, yeah, you can share it with others.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. I think we saw like a Knime Explorer. Maybe I can show. In the interest of time, I am not creating anything, but I will show what is there. So this particular workflow is for predicting the value of the, what is the target column. So you can generate the value, either random value or any file value, numerical value, and using the regression capability, machine learning capability within Knime, you can generate and use it. Since I already ran it, so these are the nodes now. If you want this one file node, go to the file node repository, just type file reader, no? So what you need to do, like double click or drag and drop, you will get that one. Once you build the nodes like this, you can connect all these nodes and complete the workflow. So, for example, I have the file reader, I have the file, I want to do some analysis. So, first I need to point to the file. So, using the configure option, you can browse and select the file location. Once that is done, file is there, I can run it. So initially it will not be in the green status, just right click or select, there is a execute button here, you can execute it. So that way the file will be loaded in the node and the memory, then you can see the file contents in the node. Okay. Similarly, you can go for other nodes. For example, I want to partition the data, one is for training, one is for test data, I can easily do that. Same way, there is a partitioning capability, I am going to split 80-20, just specify what is the relative percentage here, one partition will be 80%, or another partition will be 20%. Now, if you are using in your local standalone, so the size doesn't matter, only with the performance. So once I build the workflow, I can run the entire workflow, like execute all, or if you want to test it stage by stage, you can test it and see the data. Here also, since I partitioned, so this is 30 rows here, and in the first partition there are 120 rows. Okay. So, it is already partitioned the data into 80-20. So, final you want to like see the result stats. So this is the final outcome. Okay. So this is one of the simple example. So all you need to do, open a new window and select the required nodes based on what data you have, and build the workflow and execute it. So I was telling about the address duplication. One of the thing is you can import the extensions from the Knime extension and also from the marketplace also. If you want to explore Knime, I think whatever comes along with the tool is more than sufficient. For example,
extensions in the form of new nodes, new node types?
No, it will be workflow. You can download it as a workflow.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you go here, once you download the workflow, you can import the workflow. It's available either in a GIF format or in the workflow native Knime format. If you are like very familiar with the machine learning analytical capability, so you can see all these clustering, regression. So anybody is interested in deep learning, you want to go for TensorFlow, Keras, everything is there. This you can use this and learn, and you can build off your own also. So any questions about the tool? So if you want more details, we have very good Knime TV. If you want to learn, YouTube TV is there, and also we have a lot of resources in the Knime website. It's easy to understand also with all screenshots and all. Yeah, so the capability within Knime is you can configure. So if you want to customize the like regression, the whatever the configuration capability only you can use. So that is the limitation in Knime.
For example, let's say I want without the context.
Mm-hmm.
A simple, very classic. Want to remove the context, how do you do?
You want to remove the? Yeah, that and all you can explore. So these are the capabilities available within Knime. So whatever settings, configuration settings available, no? So using that, you can play around with that and try.
Who is using currently? Who is your like competitor or like currently who is using here? Like any big enterprise right now?
Yeah, as per Knime, mm-hmm. I don't know whether you guys heard about Alteryx. So they are saying this alternative to Alteryx,
mm-hmm.
and open source also. Yeah. Any other questions? Can you come back? Sorry. Yeah, you can integrate. See, if you have Python script or R script and Spark also, so you can integrate, or Knime can read those language and it can use that as an input. Yeah.
Questions?
So we Where is big data in this? Where is big data in this?
Big data is the input for this learning, no? So if you want to use big data, so there are within this there is a big data option. Examples also they are given. Let me find out. So there are examples how to use Knime for big data. You can. Yeah. Now he is asking how Knime can integrate with big data. So I already told now, so Python or Spark. So Spark is mainly heavily used for big data. If you want to use Knime for big data, you can write a Spark and then use the Knime capability to read the data from the Spark and use it for your visualization or predictive modeling. Thank you.